The best response you can have to a payoff in a thriller is someone goes, oh, right, I forgot, of course, I should have.
On Story offers a look inside the creative process from today's leading writers, creators, and filmmakers. All of our content is recorded live at Austin Film Festival and at our year-round events. To view previous episodes, visit onstory.tv. On Story is brought to you in part by the Alice Kleberg Reynolds Foundation, a Texas family providing innovative funding since 1979. From Austin Film Festival, this is On Story, a look inside the creative process from today's leading writers, creators, and filmmakers. This week's On Story, GLOW co-creators Liz Flahive and Carly Mensch.
We want it to be like ugly and desperate, but like incredibly beautiful. And this has to be about like a team of women with a friendship at the core. How much wrestling do we really need in a show about wrestling? And then I think the answer to that question was like a lot.
In this episode, GLOW co-creators Liz Flahive and Carly Mensch discuss adapting the real-life 80s phenomenon Gorgeous Ladies of Wrestling into a fictional series.
We showed a little piece of trivia, Gorgeous Lady of Wrestling's documentary, whenever it came out, a long time ago, and I would love to hear how you got to GLOW.
We were never a writing team. We were two playwrights working in TV who happened to work really, really well together in the writer's room, and then towards the end, you know, conversations about we should find something, we should do something together. And I think we had a hunch it would be female-centric, as everything we had worked on seemed to be about women, and that's where we were happy. But then Liz was... I feel like you were home with a...
Oh, yeah, I had had my second kid, and she was a nightmare. And so I was just like, please come over, please. And so Carly was just like hunting around for stuff while I was dealing with like a screaming newborn.
And I'm a docufile, so I was just watching my usual slate of documentaries. I saw that doc, and something about the world just felt so rich and so both in, you know, it's a bananas, cartoony... good and evil take on the 80s, but also there was so much about that doc, I don't know who's seen it, that almost feels like a League of Their Own style was even more about the women looking back on this time in their life at something that kind of, to outsiders, looked like a blip on the pop cultural radar, but for them was some of the most meaningful time in their entire lives. So I brought it to Liz, we watched it, and then I think it was literally... a one-line email to Jenji Kohan, who I had worked on both Weeds and Orange is the New Black, and she's kind of a creative mentor mother for me, and so I think the email was literally, do you want to make a TV show about women's wrestling in the 80s? And she literally wrote back, yes. That was... it took us a while to kind of figure out how to build from the center of the show, which was the female friendship at the center, to the full kind of circus that it is, and how to balance that and kind of just finding our way in.
It was not like there were three drafts. There were many, many drafts.
So I want to talk about that pilot. It's actually still one of my favorite episodes because you're talking about this strong friendship that these, not just these women have, all these women have. And yet that first episode is... the seed of the whole show built on betrayal.
And a lot of what we talked about at the beginning was the wrestling. We're not people who get wrestling. We're not people who followed wrestling. We were people who judged wrestling. And then as we were trying to figure out wrestling, we also wanted to figure out how it worked on our show, and we never wanted it to feel like it was sprinkled on to us. Here's a story about people, and then like when you get bored, we like, you know, sprinkle on some wrestling, and that's fun. It needed to both move story. It needed to kind of... illuminate things about the characters. We wanted you to follow the people into the ring. And then knowing that on some level, the first episode was our first wrestling match. It was our first big, attempt to answer, like, how will we use this? And it will always be personal. So then we kind of started with like, what are some of the most personal things you can get into a wrestling ring about?
We also really leaned into the things that made us uncomfortable about wrestling. Like, I think at first we were like, how much wrestling do we really need in a show about wrestling? And then I think the answer to that question was like a lot, ideally, and in a meaningful way. And I think once we sort of got into the, you know, just we wanted it to feel really layered, and how you were going to watch it wasn't just surface. It would be watching, you know, these women working through things in their actual life in the ring in a very particular way. So I think it took us a long time to get to the, you know, the fantasy pop, the idea that like you were going to take this like very real, super emotional, like one of our most dramatic scenes in the pilot scenes, and then transition gracefully into like a bonkers, you know, Allie and Betty circling each other as like, you know, the beginning seeds of like their characters, where you see who plays the heel and who, you know, and who plays the hero. So
I'm sorry. Is this real?
Who the f- cares?
Can you talk about that process of casting that show? And, you know, I'm sure there was a casting agent, but in your looking at people to determine, were they right?
A lot of how we talked about the show initially was that we wanted it to be a body show. It's a show about bodies, women's bodies. And so we should see all body types. And then also, you know, we said to people, this is going to sound insane, but we want all the women to do their own wrestling.
And there were people who definitely didn't want to do that. So those people didn't audition.
Probably like 80% of the people dropped out of wanting to be on the show. and the people who were left were the kind of game, you know, glow-spirited people. I think we also,
you know, we had a lot of freedom in who we cast, you know, frankly, like we, like Netflix did not, as they don't with many things, like they did not get in our way. We said who we wanted and we got who we wanted, and we were the ones who sort of had to duke it out when we didn't feel like we were there. Like, we weren't fighting with a network, we were fighting it out with each other.
It was the opposite. We were like, is Allie Brie too much of a star?
Yeah. Is she just too pretty and capable?
Yeah. And to say Betty is someone we knew from the theater world, and then she was on Nurse Jackie. And I think even before we wrote the script, we were like, Betty belongs in this world somewhere. We'll figure out where. But she is somebody who, you know, especially back then, felt a bit undiscovered, wrongly undiscovered for us, and somebody who was so judged by her looks that no one realized she was the smartest, weirdest person in the room at all times. So yes, there were some people we brought Gail Rankin to, who plays Sheila, we knew from theater, and we were like, another person that...
That you're like, you have no, nobody has any idea.
We will put her somewhere. Yeah. And then when she auditioned for Sheila, we're like, well, that was the most emotionally grounded performance of a wolf lady I've ever seen. We wrote that monologue as a kind of absurdist lark, and she just made us all cry. So I guess
that's what we're doing with that character now.
She gets her.
I've worn this, or some version of this, every day for the past 5 years. It's not a costume. It's just me. And what I do in the morning. What I put on, what I wear. It's not for you. It is for me.
In the first season, there was so much of the girls sort of getting used to each other. Like, they were really kind of feeling it out, and who is who, and who's going to be friends with who, and who are we. And now, you know, by the end of season 3, we're very much getting these individual characters on their own, and we're getting to spend some time with them and learn more about them. You know, can you talk about that development process over the 3 seasons?
I think we went very deliberately slower than even we were maybe comfortable with season 1, because we just, part of it was
also guided by the wrestling. So it's like, you know, once they learn how to wrestle, we can't go back to them not knowing. And so I think, and there was, we just didn't want to run over any story about, you know, like about learning what it was that they were doing and what connection we could find there. And so I think that was like a sort of guiding light for us, for sure. I think season two, we came in and we were like, oh, we want to tell the story of the two moms on the team. And that, and because that felt important to us. And that was another just wish list item, I think. To get by, as long as I got you, then baby, you know that you got me over. We got our love and some R-E-S-P-C-T-O. Morning dew, took one look at you, and it was plain to see that you were my destiny. With my arms open wide, I threw away my... I mean, our goal is by the end of the series to have kind of gotten to know each and every one of those women. But we are kind of going at our own pace as we do that, so that it's not kind of dictating the shape or the, you know, the story, just because it's ultimately a story of a team. It's a story of a group of women. So like, we try never to lose sight of that. And whenever we kind of break off, it's for a reason that hopefully is feeding the larger story, as opposed to kind of like, and now a detour with, and when you only have 10 episodes too, it feels, you have to be so precious with them.
The like rebellion of the show for us is the idea of like how many times we put 14 or 15 women in a frame together. Because frankly, it is not something you see all that often still, even though we're in like a better moment. You know, I think you look at so many casts and it is like many, many men and two women. And we are the opposite. And I love that we're the opposite. And I think there's something about that that feels like it is the team is the beating heart of the show, and how that team, you know, works on you and tells our story is a big part of it.
And yet you've given a lot of space to Sam and Bash. You know, they both have become very, they're not like just token.
No, they're really important characters. I mean, it's more the sort of balance of, you know, and I think that's the thing, like there are many wonderful shows where it's a lot of men and two wonderful female characters. We're just flipping that. And I think that feels, you know, and they're narratively incredibly important. And I think there is that thing for us where we're like, oh, we're still telling a story of making something in the mid 80s. And they're, you know, and there are male producers and male directors, and they hold a seat of power that is part of our story. So they're not incidental in any way.
The characters are our own, and they're on their own journeys. And with each season, we get further and further, even from anything close to the documentary. But I think that kind of foundational inspiration, which is that this should be both stupid and silly and the most meaningful pocket of time in their lives, and some of them may never work again, and some of them may never speak again, but for the however long our show is on, they're a unit.
So another thing I think, especially now this last season, that has been interesting to me is how you've woven lots of current conversations into it, and yet they don't really feel, sometimes that makes me crazy, you know, that when they're like, okay, they weren't talking about that then, but pretty much everything that we're talking about now, we were talking about then.
Yeah.
And we were talking about it maybe a little bit differently, and but it was definitely the conversation, everything from, you know, homosexuality to immigration to whatever. And you've managed to weave all those things in very realistically.
Thanks. I mean, I think it's definitely things we talk about a lot. I think there are a couple things to say. I mean, one is that we're research nerds and we go real deep on the research, which has been awesome. Like, I feel like it'll be sad when Glow ends, just because it's so fun and it's such a rich time to dig into. And we make that part of the room, you know, like we did a research trip to Vegas, which really was a research trip to Vegas. Like, we did not
We did, like, the writers were like, we're going to Vegas. I'm like, we're going to talk to a historian, and we're going to go on this tour, and we're going to go backstage here and talk to these people. And they're like, when are we going to get
Showgirl
drunk?
Showgirl Museum.
Yeah, Showgirl Museum. It was very, very
Not
dry.
Not a lot of people go to the museum side of the Showgirl story.
But I think it's that thing where, you know, you know, Carly's husband is a journalist, and I think, you know, how much you get from just speaking to people directly, and, you know, we reach out to, when we don't know, when we know we want to attack something that feels like it's coursing through our culture now, you know, we do look back and really want to know sort of how it was being dealt with then. And we have modern brains, but I think we never want to pull you out of, you know, the sort of reality of the time to say something important. So I think it's really doing a ton of homework, even if it's just for like a couple little details. It's getting as much as you can.
It is a tightrope. Like, we're trying to avoid we never want the show to feel like a museum piece. We're not people who kind of, you know, there are people who do like that. We're not kind of into just watching something. But at the same time, yes, we don't want to kind of do a revisionist history of what the 80s were. And I think that, like, season 2, episode 5, which is an episode where Ruth and, you know, a network exec kind of have an almost Me Too incident. And then, you know, so much of that episode for us, we've been asked about it a lot, was about the conversation between Ruth and Debbie afterwards, not about what actually happened in the room with Ruth and the network exec. And what was so exciting about it was, you know, Debbie says some really retrograde things, and that was kind of, for us, the power of the scene, that everything Debbie said was completely
true for her.
And yeah, I think you would hear it less today, even though maybe some people are still thinking it.
I can't believe this. I know it was terrible.
How could you be so stupid?
What are you talking about?
You're in the hotel room of the head of the network. He comes on to you and you run away?
Was I supposed to f*** him?
No, you're supposed to make him think that you might f*** him. Or that you desperately want to f*** him, if only you didn't have a fiance or your period or an extra set of teeth where your vagina should be.
I'm not that kind of person.
What, an actress?
Morphing into Bash's character. Yeah. And I mean, you've been hinting about him openly. Since season one.
Yeah, we've had a plan for that character that feels pretty
again, that conversation of how it was back in the 80s and how that conversation would happen now. Yeah. I mean, his clearly fighting against this epiphany is I love the way you've woven it into so many different things, because his character feels to me to be very real. Can you talk about how, you know, like, what the process is essentially, not just of him, but Wolf Girl as well, of how you got yourself in the plan, like, what was your plan in season one to ultimately reveal some things for us in season 3? And those two have had huge revelations, right?
Yeah. There are certain characters, and I think you just named, like, the primary two that I think we could be fully open that, like, we're not as fully fleshed out at the beginning. Just when you have that many characters, I think there are certain that you use a little shorthand for. And I think also Sam, I think, you know, some of our early notes were just a misogynist in the middle of a world of women. And for Bash, you know, it was like a wealthy playboy, son of a Republican who loves wrestling. And, you know, we're people who are humanists, so we're like, well, eventually we'll get there. But, you know, when Chris Lowell, who is an actor that we have loved, I saw him in a play at Ars Nova called Jacuzzi and was like, that guy's the guy. And Chris himself admits, he was like, when I read it and then when you guys talked to me about the character, I was a little like, okay, I guess I gotta trust you.
Like, we're like, it's deep, it's gonna go these places. And then we're like, episode 3, your helicopter takes everyone to Malibu and we have a party and there are costumes.
Enter via helicopter. We swear it's a super grounded show. We...
Who likes glittery fun things?
Is that a f***ing Bob Mackie gown?
Yeah. Why do you think my parties are so legendary? We drink, we smoke, we dance, we get naked, then we put on these awesome costumes and the cycle repeats itself. Now, why don't you go let those ladies know that there's a costume closet on the second floor?
You guys! Costume party, get naked!
there's a responsibility to telling stories about gay characters in the 80s, and I think that has also guided us on some level, and the kind of inherent tension of having that identity and being in a kind of conservative family felt really exciting to us. And then I think some of the other things that have been really helpful is so much of the show is about how people see you. That's what wrestling, you know, wrestling is kind of about the stereotype or the way people see you and then who you really are. So I think making sure we honored that for our men and then kind of slowly, slowly teasing out Bash's identity in a way that, you know, I think at season one, maybe the furthest we got was like he put on glitter eyeshadow. That was the furthest we got, even though Chris was like really subtly playing things that if you look back as early as season one, Chris uses every opportunity when he's in a scene with Mark and a man to touch him. It's so small, but
he doesn't do it with the women, but
he never touches.
And it's great.
To every man.
But you also have these really incredibly overdramatic moments, like way beyond, and then you take us back to something, you know, that's very much purely character-driven and emotional.
Like, the toggle is the fun and the toggle is the challenge, right? Like, you know, there's something, and I think finding writers and finding actors and finding directors who are comfortable playing in both sandboxes. I mean, Betty, I think part of the inspiration for casting somebody like Betty is that she is like, she makes big, big faces and big theatrical choices and then can like kill you dead with, you know, a sort of like totally grounded emotional scene. And I feel like that is sort of the spirit of the show. It's sort of like bonkers, play to the rafters, and then like kick you in the stomach. And I think another thing we learned there, because I think we were so seduced by like finally getting to see the wrestling, is we realized we needed more stuff like really closer in the ring. Like we didn't, I think it changed how we thought of season two. Like when we realized like being outside the ropes for too long is actually very distancing. Like you need to be with the girls and then you need to get even closer so you're with the people playing the characters. So the thing that makes it very hard to shoot, frankly, is how much you need to get.
But like for us, it's important from page to editing to make sure we kind of know the function of the edit of the wrestling scene, the function of kind of any huge action.
Some of my favorite scenes are in the ring. They're always, I mean,
the ring's great, man.
We write most of them, but then there are a few that there's just kind of like some kind of magical things. I think season one, episode 7, there's a wrestling montage where Ruth and Debbie learn how to work together. That Jesse Peretz directed, and there was something just about the combination of like how we were talking about that sequence, and there was a kind of, Jesse's one of those directors who's like, well, just punk rock it. Let's bring like, you know, 5 leotards with us to a location, and we'll just, let's just overshoot. Let's just, and you know, and then the sun was setting at a certain, you know, and that's one of those ones where I'm sure this montage was like 4 lines in the script, you know. And it's one of the most glorious pieces of filmmaking in, I think, the show and in that episode.
But anytime you put the Russian in the U.S., I mean, that's just such a brilliant way to...
It's the bad guy of the 80s. Yeah. It feels like you can't, you know, so much of wrestling, again, we learned was like, oh, yeah, it's really just a kind of really a lens into the fears and the prejudices of a time period. And what's fun about the 80s are the prejudices and fears are quite clear.
Carly, you watched Rocky IV for the first time, like while we were writing season one. You were like, oh my God, this is America versus, it's amazing. And I was like, oh yeah.
And then you would talk to people and they'd be like, I think in around 85, I wasn't even sure why we didn't like Russians anymore. Which was again helpful because you're like, you have to think about it from Ruth's perspective. She's playing a character and she doesn't even really understand the Cold War.
No one can defeat Zarya.
Who's that? Who's yelling from the audience?
You heard me. I said, I'll fight you. Oh, you? Bored housewife in dress?
Yeah. I am a proud American mother.
No way she was speaking.
And I refuse.
Did you know?
No, of course not. I would have told you.
In a world without freedom. And I'm ready to kick your Soviet ass all the way back to Siberia.
If other people made Glow, I'm sure there's a not three-dimensional version of it that would be some insane sitcom that would also be probably delightful in other ways. But we're people who are, you know, we're not writing a show about Zoya the Destroyer, we're writing a show about Ruth trying to play the character Zoya the Destroyer, standing in a ring, not with Liberty Bell, but with her best friend Debbie, whose husband she slept with, who's also grappling with a bunch of shit she tries to play Liberty Bell. So that kind of always brings you back to the people, and then I think you're kind of, you're starting in the right place when you're not like, okay, Russians versus Americans in the ring. You're kind of like, okay, that was the idea. Step back. Follow the people.
You've been watching On Writing Glow on Story. On Story is part of a growing number of programs in Austin Film Festival's On Story project, including the On Story PBS series, now streaming online, the On Story radio program, the On Story podcast, and the On Story book series, available where books are sold. To find out more about On Story and Austin Film Festival, visit onstory.tv or austinfilmfestival.com. Want to see On Story live? Join us at Austin Film Festival's annual Writers Conference each October. Visit www.austinfilmfestival.com to find out more about badges and passes to attend the festival.